Welcome back to the summer of 67 here in Strike Fighters 2. We're back into action today over Vietnam here on June 30th, 1967. This is a week after our previous mission, as usual. The Enterprise's cruise will be ending in July of 1967. Not sure exactly when, but this is definitely our last mission here in June, and then we only have anywhere between 1 and 4 missions left before the Enterprise heads back to the West Coast to end its deployment. And of course I won't be going with it. Once it leaves, then a new campaign will start, and I'm thinking most likely going to be doing A4 Skyhawk for the next couple of months. We are to strike a strategic target located in Cap Bai, which is in Haiphong, destroy the enemy POL storage tank in the target area. Call sign will be Trout, will be taking 3 F4 Phantoms. Takeoff time 7:48 in the morning, over the target by 7:01, back to Yankee Station for landing by 7:23. Today's loadout is going to be 18 Mark 82 500-pound bombs with the Snake Eye Fin attachment on the back, perfect for low-level deployment. In addition to that, we have our 4 Sidewinders, 4 Sparrows, and our 600-gallon centerline drop tank for total takeoff weight today of 59,770 pounds. And we confirm that all aircraft do have the same loadout. Here's our map for today. We'll be taking off from Yankee Station, flying north up to Waypoint 3, climbing up to a cruise altitude of 7,600 feet. Once we hit Waypoint 3, we turn northwest, heading up towards our initial point, which is directly over the Cat Ba Island. On our way in, just a few miles out from Cat Ba, we'll begin a descent down to 1,000 feet. Once we hit Cat Ba and the initial point, it's due west, directly into the heart of the Haiphong Harbor to strike at these POL tanks. We can see the situation a little more clearly here in these recon photos. Here's the city of Haiphong along the banks of the Cam River. Along the west bank there, you can see row after row of the actual docks, and down at the very southern tip, in that circle there, that is the tank farm that we'll be striking. We'll be coming in due west from the east, passing over the river, and then releasing as we head over downtown Haiphong, pulling out and then down to the south as our bombs impact. Here's a more detailed photo of the target site. You can see we have about 12 tanks that are going to have to go, so we're going to try to put as many bombs into there as possible and just wipe them all out. As we take a look at all the nearby airfields, we can see nothing but AN-2 squadrons. There are no MiGs left in North Vietnam right now. They've either all been shot down or retreated up to the north into China, where they are recuperating, retraining. And that's reflecting the real-life situation in the summer of 67. With that being the case, we can probably expect that these last few missions of this campaign will be mostly strike missions. After we hit the port, we're turning due south, down to Waypoint 6, climbing back up to 7,600 feet once we're clear of any enemy defenses in the area, and then proceeding further down south, returning back to Yankee Station to land back on the Enterprise. Heavy strike day today into the capital region. We'll be seeing lots of squadrons heading up with us and then splitting off to their own individual targets. Here's one squadron of note. This will be Bison Flight, which is going to be 2 A4 Skyhawks off the USS Bonhomme Richard. They'll be flying Iron Hand right in the Cat Bai area, so probably providing cover for us, so we can expect to see some Skyhawks around, hopefully suppressing some air defenses to keep us covered as we get in, hit the target at low altitude, and then get out. Here's today's roster. I'm in Trout 1. Trout 2 is going to be Ensign Ray Voden. Trout 3, Ensign Keith Alvarez. We haven't taken Alvarez for a while because his condition got down pretty low, but we can see that he's back up to 83 condition, so that should be good enough to take him out on another run. Alright, that wraps up today's briefing. We'll be taking 3 Phantoms on a low-level strike right into the very heart of Haiphong. Trout Flight is up on the deck and ready to go. Checking those control surfaces, they're looking good. There's Ensign Voden off to my left, jet blast deflector coming up. As we both apply full power, full afterburner, salute down to the shooter, and we sit back and wait for the ride. And Trout 1 is airborne. Skimming above the waves here as we make our Case 1 departure, climbing to 500 feet, heading 7 miles out from the ship before we climb to our departure course. And there's Ensign Alvarez just clear of the deck, so all of Trout Flight is airborne. And the wingmen are going to start grouping up on my wing in formation. There's 500 feet. Wing leveler is on as we turn the radar on and the ECM. Additionally, let's put the flight into wedge formation today. So we're not going in as fighters, so we don't need to worry about the loose deuce so much. I would rather have the guys in a close wedge formation so our ECMs can overlap and provide us protection against SAMs and AAA radars over Vietnam. And there we go, that's about a minute out, so full power, and I'm going to climb up, and we're going to swing around behind the fleet as we get on course. So the nice thing is, with this new extra added time that I've given us for the takeoff, I don't have to rush every time to get out ahead of the AI formations or catch up with them. You know, that's been a problem sometimes. But here, we have the option to just have a nice leisurely marshalling get-together. And so that's what I'm doing here. I'm coming around behind the fleet to make sure that we're not going to outrun any of the friendly squadrons, because we don't want to be the first squadron into Vietnam. Then we're targets to the air defenses. But if we can all go in together, as the strike is designed to be, then we sort of provide mutual protection, and it's a target-rich environment, a lower percentage possibility that we will be the ones targeted. There we go, and we're real heavy today, so a touch of afterburners to get us up over 300 knots, which is where I like to climb at, but we'll get a little boost of speed up over it and then pull back the throttles. Again, real heavy because of the bomb load today, so we're not climbing like in our fighter configuration. There's a bit of the fleet down there at Yankee Station, looks like an Essex-class carrier. And there's more of the fleet to the right, and that might actually be the Enterprise down there, hard to tell. And we've gone up over 7,600 feet because I wasn't paying attention, so no problem. We're just going to let the plane settle back down to altitude, to 76, and I'm going to pull the power back as we get set up for our cruise into Vietnam. There we go, there's 76. Wing leveler engaged, and we'll pull the fuel flow back to 400 pounds per hour for a nice economic fuel. And take a look at the APR-25 there. You can see that we're already getting pinged by ground radars out at our 11 o'clock. Now those are North Vietnamese early warning radars. And you can see, look, we're still over the fleet. I mean, we've just climbed to altitude. We're about 50 miles away from waypoint 3 and then maybe another 50 from the shore. So 100 miles away from Vietnam, but that's still within their radar range. The P-35 early warning radar has a range of over 200 miles, depending on target altitude and size. But you can see here at 7,600 feet over the fleet, we are clearly visible to the North Vietnamese. They know that we're coming. And this is why I click the ECM on as early as possible. We get those ALQ-100s fired up because they know that we're coming, and they only have about 20 minutes to organize defenses, but if we're throwing deceptive radar jamming back at them, and their screens are just loaded with a lot of ghost blips, then they don't know exactly how big the force is. So there is still some questions there. They're not quite so confident that they know what's coming. Let's take a look at our Snake Eye loadout today, and talk about U.S. general purpose bombs. The Mark 80 series of bombs are still the primary U.S. general purpose bombs today, and they have been in use since Vietnam. In 1946, with aircraft speeds increasing and the introduction of jet engines, a study was made which concluded that the bombs of World War II were producing too much drag on the aircraft. Ed Heinemann, chief engineer of Douglas Aircraft, designed a new low-drag bomb shape called Arrow 1A. Arrow 1A has a length-to-diameter ratio of 8 to 1, giving the new bombs a skinny and streamlined shape, which reduces parasite drag. The narrow bodies also allowed for groups of bombs to be packed tightly together on external racks. Ed Heinemann was the same Douglas designer that produced the SBD Dauntless, the A-1 Sky Raider, the A-4 Skyhawk, and over 20 other famous aircraft. The 80 series began service in the 1950s and finally saw combat with the start of the Vietnam War. The Mark 81 was a 250-pound bomb. The Mark 82 was 500 pounds. The Mark 83 was 1,000. And the Mark 84 was 2,000 pounds. Of the 500 pounds of a Mark 82, 190 pounds are explosives, and the rest is the weight of the forged steel body. Damage is primarily caused by the fragmentation of this body. The bomb fragments can cause incapacitation of a person up to 820 feet away from the point of impact, though damage can still occur out to as far as 1,400 feet. This includes into the air, so we want to avoid dropping 500-pounders under 1,400 feet. Unguided Mark 82s at the beginning of Vietnam only had a 5.5% chance of hitting their targets, requiring large numbers to be dropped to ensure a hit. Air Force Mark 82s can contain one of two types of high explosive, composition H6 or tritonal. Composition H6 is a mixture of TNT, aluminum, calcium chloride, and RDX, a more explosive compound than TNT. Tritonal is a mix of TNT and aluminum only. After the 1967 fire aboard the Forrestal that killed 134 sailors and wounded 160 more, the U.S. Navy began producing its own variants of the 80s series of bombs. These use a thermally insensitive explosive called PBXN-109, specially designed for use aboard carriers. The bombs are also coated with a special exterior nicknamed gator skin for its rough texture, and this insulates the bomb body to reduce the chance of inadvertent explosions in a shipboard environment. It's certain that these two important modifications saved many lives in the 1969 Enterprise fire, where flight deck crew members were picking up burning bombs from the deck and heaving them overboard before they could explode. Testing later showed that a Navy Mark 82 can burn for 2.5 minutes before it explodes. Another feature of the 80s series is its modular design. The basic Mark 82 can be configured with a variety of fuses, tail units, or guidance systems. When fitted with the typical low-drag tail fins, the bomb is a simple unguided munition. However, several bomb retardation units can also be fitted to the back, such as the Mark 15 Snake Eye fin that we have equipped today. Retardation devices, often fins or parachutes, allow the bombs to be dropped at low altitude and low speed while still allowing the aircraft to escape the detonation. The Mark 15 Snake Eye was used heavily during Vietnam, especially in close air support missions against ground troops. When laser-guided bombs and other precision munitions arrived in Vietnam in the 70s, they came as guidance and control fin packages that bolted onto 80s series bombs. The GBU-12 Paveway was the original laser-guided variant of the Mark 82, allowing the 500-pound bomb to be placed on targets with precision. Over 4,500 Paveways would later be dropped on Iraq during the 1990 Persian Gulf War. Later precision guidance packages would use electro-optical, infrared, and finally GPS for all-weather precision. Today in the game, we are still a year away from the first in-country tests of the laser-guided Paveways, so we're still relying on unguided bombing. And with the Mark 15 Snake Eyes on board, we'll be making a low-altitude, level bombing run, which is a departure from our usual dive bombing approach. Tactics were not standardized during Vietnam, and often a squadron or even an individual flight leader had their own preferences on how to approach targets. The benefits of a dive bomb were greater accuracy and more damage on target, and the high approach altitude kept the planes safe from small arms fire. The downsides were easy radar locks for SAMs and AAA. On the other hand, a low, fast approach could help mask the aircraft from radar, and AAA guns had less time to ID and fire at a passing target. However, below 4,700 feet, aircraft were vulnerable to any AK-47 or a long rifle on the ground, and a hail of undetected rounds coming from a village or a rice paddy could down an aircraft without warning. Finally, the bombing itself was far less accurate, and a larger bomb spread meant less damage to the target area. The plan of attack for today is to drop to 1,000 feet AGL and speed at full throttle into the target. Level at 1,000 and at 500 knots, I'll watch the target, and just as it disappears under the bottom of the heads-up display, that is, becoming obscured behind the cowl of the instrument panel, that's when I release the bombs. With the medium release time that I've selected, I should have a run of explosions that will walk right through the target area, even if I drop slightly early. We're in and out of the target very quickly, and then we maintain low altitude as I turn tightly over to escape the area and head back out to sea. Alright, we are on our way into Vietnam now, just a few miles out from Cat Ba, with the initial point over the top of the island. Double check the ECM is on, because I can see that there's a whole mess of radars checking us out now. You can see there on the raw equipment, on the vector raw. We're 25 miles out from the island. Fuel gauge is still showing that we're on the external tank still. The coastal islands are just coming into view there. You can see there's like a mountain or something there. These are all the little coastal islands that are dotted along south of the Vietnamese and also the Chinese mainland. And we can just see them coming in through the horizon there now. So there's Cat Ba, which is the big island. You can see just to the west of it, that little island, that's Cat Hai Island. And we can see that there's a P-35 on it. And we've had dealings with that island before. Two missions ago, that was the night and stormy mission, the dark and stormy mission. That was the island where the wingman was making multiple attack runs on and actually took out that P-35 and some AAA there. So apparently the P-35 has been rebuilt or repaired or replaced. It's back in operation either way. And we're gonna go right over that island, and we know that it's got AAA, so that's gonna be a bit of a dangerous run as we roll over it. Getting back on course here as I'm diving down to 1,000 feet above the ground, or above the waves here. Wingmen are sort of with me, but I'm sure they'll close up once we level out. Haiphong out to the left there at 11 o'clock, and out to the right is the city of Ha Long there on the coast. That's actually a huge tourist attraction now. It's a big tourist city. Obviously not the case here in 1967. And I see there's a bit of mountains here on Cat Ba, so we'll just level out here at 1350. Still on the drop tank, which is excellent. We have lots of fuel to hit those burners as we turn towards the target in a moment and make a high-speed run in to drop our bombs here on the tranquil port of Haiphong this morning. Look at that. You can see little fishing villages dotting the coastline here on the island. Two miles out. And SAMs are active today. There's the wingman in position, selecting the snake eyes. Then there we go. We have hit our initial point. So tight bank over, due west. There's the gray smudge of Haiphong. There's Cat Hai Island just ahead of us. And I zoom in, I can see the docks and target should be just right around there. Look at that, there's the radar facility down low and left, and we're picking up flak from that facility. As we're zooming by 500 knots, whoa! Tracers coming up, trying to get us, but we are over the island already. Alright, primary target is in sight. I can see those POL tanks. flak is banging all around me. And let's get the guys to attack my target. We're over 550 knots, 850 feet, waiting for those targets to disappear underneath the instrument panel, and then I'm going to release the bombs. Here we go, we're coming up on it. Stand by. Release! And there go the snake eyes, their fins popping up behind them, dragging the bombs away from us so we can safely escape the bomb blasts, and wingmen dropping bombs also. Direct hit! Into the POL storage. Tank farm destroyed. More shockwaves rolling out from wingmen bombs as we are right over the rooftops of Haiphong here. Alright, pulling around to the south. Let's get the fuck out of here. Tight turn. There we go, down to the south. Deselect the weapons. And we're out over the southern part of the city already. Ooh, there's the smoke plume from the tank farm. Look at that. Solid hits in there. Huge petroleum fires right now, no doubt. Shit, and there's Canaan Airfield just off to the right. Jeez. Heavy flak here over this little peninsula or coastline here. Just keep it jinking. Jesus Christ, what is... Whew. God damn. Alright, looks like we're clear. Let's get the squadron back together. In fact, I wonder what the guys are up to. I don't even know where they're at. More SAMs flying up into the air. We have some AAA units. Actually targeted here along the coast, right near that airfield. More SAMs going up at our guys. We had literally nothing last time. The entire air defense system was shut down, and now today, SAMs everywhere, flak everywhere. Whatever they were waiting for last week, they are out to get us today. And here's Iron Hand A4s rocking the AAA around Kianan as I'm continuing my lazy circle around looking for the wingmen. Looks like another tank farm down there. Oh, I see flak bursting. Maybe at that A4 squadron? Oh, look at that! Cluster bombs going off right down there to the 11 o'clock low. Oh, and there's somebody right there. There's one of the A4s. Looks like he's pulling out on his attack run. So if the wingies still have bombs on board, which apparently they do because they let me order them to attack these targets, I don't want to go back to the ship with spare bombs, and we sort of have a minute of sort of peace. There's another A4. What was that? Crab flight, I think? They're down and dirty. Trying to get the wingmen to expend their final bombs on some of these AAA targets right on the coast. Any additional damage we can do will only help us and other flights out later on our next missions. Geez, I don't know how far away those wingmen were. Would they fly all the way into Vietnam here? Well, here we go. Here's two. He is. He's heading inland over Haiphong. Oh, shit. And there's three. Ensign Alvarez took some heavy damage. All right, you guys. Reform. Maybe don't worry about dropping bombs at this point. I didn't realize that Trout 3 took heavy damage already, but you could just see... when we looked at both those guys, they do still have bombs on board. So they did not drop them en masse onto the primary target. All right, we're far south now of Haiphong and Qian'an, so I'm just going to climb up to cruise altitude, and we're going to head back out to sea. Back down to 400 pounds per hour. Let's see what the wingmen are up to. Oh, geez, here's two taking heavy flak. This is Ensign Voden. Despite my orders to return to the squadron, looks like he is hell-bent on dropping his bombs on something. Flying through heavy air defenses. Hopefully he can get this done without getting shot down. What are you doing, guy? You just circling? Well, here's three. Okay, three is saying, screw this, he's on his way out. And probably glad to be doing so. God, look how bad that damage is across the fuselage. What did he get hit by? And there we go, two dropping his final snake eyes. Thank God, all of them at once. So now he'll just be inclined to return back to formation. As he's all alone over Vietnam right now, without the protection of our ECM. And no joy on whatever he was firing at. So, Trout 2, return to formation. As he's just being missed by both flak and tracers. Alright, let's maybe go around one more time. One final 360. And hopefully collect these wingmen. Get them back on the wing and proceed back to Yankee Station. Two is still over Vietnam, though. I want to make sure that he is safe before we... I don't want to just leave him behind. There's Nam Dinh out in front of us there, but we're pretty far away from Haiphong already. Sam's still going crazy back there. Alright, there's a guy. That was an F4. By a guy, I meant one of my wingmen. Just to be clear. It's not just a random guy. Oh shit, we've got a Sam at Ensign Voden. God damn it, dude. Well, he can dodge. He's got chaff dispensers now. So we're just going to continue orbiting, and hopefully he'll be out joining us in a moment. And there we go, rolling out on course. We'll maintain around 10,000 feet. There's three. And there's two. So he's pretty far out to sea at this point. And I don't see any missiles chasing him, so I think whatever fired, he defeated or dodged at this point. He's probably far enough out that he doesn't have to worry about any further missiles, I hope. And he's mostly good, mostly safe. So we're just going to head back to the ship now at this point. I'm confident that... Oh, there we go. There's two, swinging right behind us, pulling around in formation. All right, so we're all safe, and I don't have to leave anybody behind. Although I was ready to at this point, because he would have been safe anyways. And we're 14 miles out from... waypoint, whatever that is, 7, I think. Using a bit of rudder there to see if we can yaw around. The rudder doesn't always work great when you have the wing leveler on, because then the autopilot is trying to fight against the roll, you know, which is what I'm trying to get through the rudder. Use the rudder to just get a bit of roll going, and you know, it doesn't work if then the autopilot is using aileron to fight that. So, man, look how bad Ensign Alvarez is hit. I don't know when that happened. I don't know if that was post-target, which I guess would sort of make sense as we came right over the harbor. I mean, there was a lot of stuff going by, flak and tracers, so maybe he picked something up after the target. We'll find out when we look at the log in the debriefing. 2 miles out now from waypoint 7, so ECM can turn off. We don't have any more threats out here. And there we go. There is waypoint 7. We're on to waypoint 8. We're 36 miles away. We still have over 10,000 pounds of fuel. We're on the internals now, but only just. We still have the drop tank affixed to us. I'll probably just bring that back to the boat at this point. There's no reason to dump it. But yeah, like, we haven't even... We are on the internal tanks, but we haven't even gone below 10,000 pounds yet, so pretty fuel efficient today. Probably because we didn't use a lot of afterburners to get up to altitude, like I sometimes do. We saw on the way in earlier that the Air Force joined us today with a huge strike package into Hanoi, and part of that force was a rare F-104 starfighter sighting. The F-104C was the fighter-bomber variant of the plane, with added pylons for ground ordnance and a mid-air refueling probe. F-104s made two deployments to Southeast Asia, in 1965-66, and again in 1966-67. Beginning in April of 65, two squadrons began flying escort missions out of Da Nang Air Base to protect F-105 Thunder Chiefs. They also flew escort for the EC-121 Warning Stars, codenamed Big Eye, that circled over the Gulf of Tonkin and provided radar control to fighters. F-104s recorded no air-to-air kills during their time, but they flew over 5,000 sorties over the course of the two deployments. They were successful in deterring MiG interceptors, who were reluctant to engage the starfighters, and they had good performance as close air support and AAA suppression aircraft. 14 F-104s were lost in total, 7 to ground fire, and 1 was shot down by a Chinese MiG over the island of Hainan. Captain Philip Smith became lost while on an EC-121 escort mission, and with several equipment failures and incorrect steering commands from both Da Nang and his tanker, he ended up wandering over Chinese airspace. J-6s, the Chinese version of the MiG-19, were scrambled from Hainan and shot down Smith over the island, where he was captured and held prisoner until 1973. The F-104 squadrons transitioned to F-4s in July of 1967, so this is the last time that we'll see any starfighters in the campaigns. Another interesting aircraft that served in Southeast Asia was the F-102 Delta Dagger. The F-102 had actually been deploying to Thailand since 1962, long before the Vietnam War. During the Laotian Civil War, ground radars picked up what were thought to be North Vietnamese IL-28 bombers. F-102 detachments were dispatched to Thailand to fly intercept missions should the bombers ever threaten Laos, South Vietnam, or Thailand. They were never used to intercept bombers, but as the Vietnam War heated up, F-102s flew air superiority missions over Thailand and South Vietnam, securing the airspace against Vietnamese MiG incursions and protecting outgoing and returning Air Force flights. When the B-52 strikes against Vietnam began, codenamed Arclight, F-102s escorted the big bombers to and from targets. The only F-102 loss to MiGs occurred during an Arclight mission. MiG-21s approached a strike flight undetected and fired AA-2 ATOL missiles at the escorts. One F-102 was hit, the ATOL burying itself in the Dagger's tail before exploding a minute later, destroying the aircraft. The F-102 wingman fired AIM-4 Falcon missiles at the retreating MiGs, but the missiles failed to hit. The Delta Dagger was used in Vietnam all the way into 1968, with air-to-ground missions supplementing its escort role. Daggers out of Da Nang equipped air-to-ground rockets in their bomb bays to blast soft targets along the Ho Chi Minh Trail. For night missions, the plane's infrared search and track system allowed them to fire heat-seeking falcons at ground targets along the trail. Two-seater TF-102As were used in-country as forward air controllers. With the conclusion of Operation Rolling Thunder in 1968, all F-102s returned to the United States. So sort of the downside of coming back with so much fuel, in a way it's sort of beneficial to burn it all off in the mission, because that's going to make us significantly heavier during landing. In fact, when I would watch flight ops on the Enterprise constantly, you'd see the F-18s, the F-14s come over, and they would just be dumping fuel on the downwind leg of the pattern. And the reason they were doing that was to shed the excess weight, so they were down within their maximum landing weights. So if they came back with too much fuel, they just jettisoned it overboard into the water at the expense of the taxpayers. So we don't have the mechanic to jettison fuel here in the game. So if it was really a concern, I could just, you know, maybe fly the full afterburners and just burn it off. But we'll be all right. We're not so heavy that the plane is unlandable. But that's a very long and tangential way of me saying that I'm going to have to account for a greater weight on the landing today. There we go. There's the first ships coming into view at Yankee Station. There's a carrier. Dead ahead. That actually might be the Enterprise, based on how the waypoints looked. And Voden is not separating. All right, he's going to stay with me on the overflight. Oh yeah, that's the Enterprise dead ahead. You see the nav arrows reporting right at it. And we can just sort of make out the big square superstructure. Hook is down and locked. And we're a bit under 1,000 feet as we're rolling out parallel to the ship's course, starboard side, for our flyby. And you can see we're going to be coming by just at 10,000 pounds of fuel. There she is. A4s parked on the deck. Some F4s. And as we come over, Ensign Voden, return to base. There we go. Trout 2 and 3 are in the brake. And as I chop the throttle and pop the brakes, Trout 1 is in the brake. There's 250. Brakes in. Gear down. As I'm watching the AOA indexer up at 20 units. And flaps down to landing position. And the flaps add so much lift when I drop them, it really pops us back up through the altitude. Alright, landing configuration, we're on the downwind. 170 knots, we're a little low at 700-ish feet, but that's alright. And we're just coming abreast of the landing area there, so we begin our turn for base and final. AOA is getting a little high, so touch of throttle, keep us skidding through the turn. Watching my shadow down there in the waves. Alright, rolling out. Heading towards the landing area. This thing settle down towards the deck. Bit of power to stop our descent and capture. Brakes. All right. Excellent. Radar is off and fold up the airplane here. the end of that flight deck was coming up awfully fast. So in addition to the arresting wire, stood on the brakes a little bit. So you saw how dangerously close we were to the end of the flight deck. In real life, the arresting gear would actually pull us backwards. As the plane comes to a screeching halt, the plane handler runs out and gives a motion to the arresting gear crew, and they give a little tug, retracting the wire just a little bit, and then it pulls the airplane backwards. So one, it disengages the wire from the arresting hook. It would also pull us back away from the edge of the flight deck there and give us a little bit more room to swing around and clear the landing area. And then once the wire is clear of the aircraft and the hook goes up, then the plane handler gives a sign, and then the crew retracts the wire all the way back into its ready position in the landing area. All right, angled parking spot here on Cat 1. Open the canopies, and we'll see you downstairs for the debriefing. All right, back down into the old ready room here. Just for clarification, this picture is not from the Enterprise. I think it's from the Hornet, or who's out on the West Coast? Yeah, that's the Hornet. I think it's from that ship. But anyways, it gets the point across. It's a ready room. On the Enterprise, most of the ready rooms, if not all of them, were located on the O3 deck, which is the deck just below the flight deck. So it's actually in between the hangar bay and the flight deck. That was the O3 deck, and that's where a lot of officer country was, and all of these ready rooms. When I worked in the calibration lab, we actually had the responsibility to maintain and clean one of the ready rooms. So it was really cool to go there during cleaning stations in the mornings and just sort of lock ourselves in there and be able to sit in the comfy seats. And because it was already clean. I mean, especially, you know, when we're in port or when we're not deployed, there's no squadrons on board, which is why we owned it. We owned the space because there are no squadrons to use it. So that also means that it's not getting dirty. So we would clean for 5 minutes and then take the rest of the hour to like just hang out and sit in the comfy seats. Anyways, talk about being tangential again. Let's get back to our actual debrief here. Our objective was to strike a strategic target located in Cat Bai, or Haiphong. Destroy the enemy POL storage tank in the target area. Flight time was 38 minutes and 3 seconds. Result was, primary target was destroyed, boy howdy was it, and 1F4 was damaged, and that was Ensign Alvarez in Trout 3. Outstanding success, score of 3850, that's huge. We must have destroyed so many of those tanks. I sort of wanted to circle back around and survey the damage before we left, but I don't know, the harbor was too hot with AAA to warrant the danger of that, so opted to not do that, probably for the best. Okay, Commander Horner dropped 18 500-pound snake eyes for 9 hits and 5 kills. Ensign Voden and Alvarez, they also dropped, well, almost all of their bombs for no hits and no kills. I can't believe that. They did not have a good day. I mean, okay, so Alvarez doesn't have a high skill set at the moment, so maybe that's sort of understandable. But we've had Voden with us before. He's been flying with us this whole campaign, and he didn't manage to hit anything, including that AAA or whatever he was shooting at the end. Okay, so this clarifies something else as well. So as we were on our way into the target, we were over that little island of Cat High, and this 12.7mm heavy machine gun fired at me at 7:03:16. Ensign Alvarez was hit by that 12.7mm. So I don't know. We saw those tracers coming up. I don't know if they missed me and just accidentally hit Alvarez, you know, behind me, if it just deflected into him, or if there was separate things firing at him that also hit him. But that's where he took the damage. He took 3 rounds, or 3 bursts. I don't know how many actual rounds that is, but no wonder why he had extensive damage. So that was way before we hit the target. That was making the run in. So 7:03:50, I began dropping my snake eyes, and so did Alvarez. He began dropping snake eyes as well. And Voden gets in the action. So all 3 aircraft, we were all dropping bombs on the primary target, but looks like maybe my bombs just took out a bunch of things first before the other guys could get hits. So at 7:03:58, I hit and destroyed 1, 2, 3, 4 POL tanks and one industrial structure, whatever the hell that is. Maybe one of those little buildings that was on the outskirts of the tank farm. Not really sure, but we got 3 tanks, including the primary target with one of them, and somehow the other guys ended up missing completely. Didn't take out any of the other tanks, unfortunately. Then we have a crap ton of AAA fire. Here at 7:08 and 52, Ensign Voden, he begins dropping those snake eyes on something. I'm thinking maybe it's this S-60 AAA that's firing at him while he's firing it at it. Luckily, it did not hit him, but he didn't strike anything either with the bombs. And then the final thing was at 7:10 and 36, that SA-2 fired a SAM at Ensign Voden as he was egressing out of the country. Luckily, to no effect. And also, how very lucky that that's the only SAM that my flight took today, considering the hellacious amount of missiles that were flying through the sky today. And that AAA, I mean, just everything was coming at us today. For as much as they fired at sort of everybody else, we were lucky enough to only get one SAM and some minimal machine gun fire. Okay, finally, over to the roster. I have 65 combat missions, 29 air-to-air kills, 118 air-to-ground, and so no change for the other two wingmen either, since they didn't hit shit today. But Ensign Keith Alvarez, who we always like to keep an eye on just for stats reasons, to sort of see how the mechanics of the game work, he's got 4 combat missions, 2 air-to-air kills, and we'll take a look at him in the next briefing and see how his stats increased. I think it's 1 experience point, or no, 1 skill point per mission, and then 2 experience points. I don't know. We'll check it out next time. But that's all she wrote for this one. Pretty good mission today, other than some light damage. At least nobody was wounded. Nobody was shot down. Like I said, with the departure of most MiGs, I'm expecting to mostly have strike missions from here on out. We're very used to seeing me do dive bombing missions. We did a low altitude level bombing strike today, and in my random readings on the internet of different Vietnam era things, I actually found a description of the Navy pop-up bombing that they would do on occasion. So we're going to try that out the next time we have a strike mission, which I think is going to be next mission. So come back for that. We're going to give the third option for bombing targets a try. We'll see how that works out. So hope to see you then. Have a great rest of day.